Welcome to AWS for Data on YouTube. I'm Rousseau Dasgupta, and I lead the UK B2B fintech business here at AWS. I'm really excited to be welcoming two senior leaders from one of our UK headquartered fintechs today, Preqin. Jack and James, if you could quickly just introduce yourselves and briefly what you do at Preqin.
Sure, thanks, Rousseau. I'm Jack. I head up Platform, manage all of our integrations and our wider platform services.
Hi, Rousseau. I'm a VP of engineering at Preqin. I work in the general partners business unit and the platform business unit with Jack.
Wonderful. Well, it's wonderful to have you here in the studio. And also, may I compliment you on your sock game before we even get started?
Thank you so much. It's very similar to yours.
It's a wonder why. No, very good. So for viewers who aren't familiar, what are the business problems that you solve at Preqin?
Sure. Well, at Preqin, we essentially empower financial professionals, anyone who invests in or allocates to alternatives. We give them the tools to make confident investment decisions. We've developed a wide range of solutions, really to support the entire life cycle of investments. Mm-hmm. And that ranges from fundraising to allocation decisions, to capital deployment and portfolio monitoring. And with our Preqin Anywhere solutions, which encompasses our APIs, our feeds, our integrations, and our third-party plugins, and we really try and make it as easy to integrate our data as possible.
Mm-hmm. And what was the initial vision of the company? How's that evolved over time?
Yeah, I mean, we've been in the business 20 years. In fact, Preqin was started in 2003 mm-hmm. by Mark O'Hare and Nick Arnott, and was really built upon this ambition to increase the transparency of private markets through data. They really came up with this pioneering approach for data collection, mm-hmm. and it enabled them to build the first, or one of the foremost, private equity databases for fund performance. Fast forward 20 years on, we're now over 1,500 employees, and we support over 200,000 investment professionals. We are 100% and remain 100% focused on alternatives, and really make sure that we have the most complete, comprehensive, and in-depth data set across the key asset classes.
Oh, brilliant. And obviously, you've been in business for over 20 years. I mean, sure, a lot has changed in that time. How has AWS kind of gone with you on that journey and helped you to evolve and scale?
So we migrated to the cloud in 2017. And what it's really enabled us to do is scale to our customers mm-hmm. and also focus on really where we're going to provide value. It's also changed the way that we think and buy technology. In terms of some of the AWS specific things that have really helped us change our business, mm-hmm. I think the data exchange has really helped with our feeds business and integrations.
Yeah, absolutely.
So Jack, James, you know, I'd love to go a bit deeper on kind of your data strategy. And I know listeners at home, you'll be thinking about Gen AI a lot these days. Everyone's talking about generative AI, but I think what we've really seen is from talking to our customers that a lot of customers just aren't even ready for Gen AI in production yet. And it's really given them a chance to really look at the data foundations they have in their companies, looking at their overall data strategy, the culture that they have internally around data, as well as the data platforms that they build that even enable use cases like AI and Gen AI. So suppose where I'd love to start is to think about, you know, what role does data play in Preqin strategy as a company?
Well, I guess, you know, data is in our DNA. So we really believe that a successful data strategy, it's got to align to what our customers need and expect from us. And to that end, we've really tried to bring our data organization and our product organization closer together. And we've built out cross-functional teams that align to the type of customer types we have. Mm-hmm. Look, it goes without saying that for a business like ours, the focus on data quality is absolute. You know, we can build the best software tools in the world, the best integrations, the best APIs, but if the data isn't right, none of that really matters. Mm-hmm. So, you know, to ensure that, we've continually invested in people, process, and technology to make sure that we can really do this at scale.
Great. And that last point you mentioned, the people, process, technology, I mean, that's really, really important. It's what we've really seen as kind of unlocking a lot of these benefits for a lot of our customers. What I'd really love to know is, can you share any key insights or changes internally that you've had from doing that and, you know, they've been driven by data internally in your company?
Sure, maybe James, you can speak to that.
Yeah, I mean, one of the big things we did is, as Jack mentioned, we're bringing various elements together, and one of the biggest changes was bringing product analysts into our cross-functional teams. That really gave us the ability to start looking at what our customers were doing in a way that gave us that extra edge of professionalism. And it also gave us the ability to identify high value actions for our customers and then start thinking about ways to get them to move them to that value faster and more efficiently, and overall providing a better user experience and customer experience too.
That's really, really interesting to hear. And I think what's really unique about you as a company, and maybe it's a little bit different from what viewers may have seen on some of our other interviews, is that you're not only talking about your own data strategy, but you also monetize your data and sell it to customers as your main product. So I'd really love to talk a little bit more about how you shape your customers' data strategies as well. So first, I'd like to know, what kind of product choices have you made to better support your customers' data strategy?
Sure. I mean, I'd say something I've noticed, especially over the last 5 years, is that our customers and their appetite for technology is increasing in sophistication. Now more than ever, I think they see the value of seeing our data tightly integrated into their own ecosystems. Like a lot of companies in our field, we started out with data feeds, built out APIs, but what's become really clear to us is to do this at scale, we have to lower the barrier to our adoption, or to coin an Amazon term, meet our customers where they are. Mm. So to that end, we're looking at what sort of tools and services we can build on top of our APIs. Mm. As James mentioned just previously, the AWS Data Exchange has been a great exemplar of this for us. And based on customer feedback, we've also gone further to build out direct integrations to some of the most widely used CRM tools, as well as BI and analytics tools too.
Now that's amazing, and it's really good to hear about that. One thing I also wanted to dive a bit deeper on is, are there any key customer roadmap items that you've kind of implemented to keep up with the data requirements that customers have as they change over time?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. It's front and center for a company like us. Without giving away too many secrets, some of the big ticket items we're looking to tackle this year are around search. You mentioned Gen AI earlier, and that may not be the technology we use, but I think the spirit of helping our customers get to data and get to value quicker is absolutely something we're going to lean into this year. So really kind of improving that ability to also map our data. We're hyper aware that we don't exist in a silo. We're one of many providers for a number of our customers. So how can we make it ever more easy for them to map our data into A, their existing proprietary data, and also other third-party data providers that they're taking data from? We're also building out a suite of internal tools. As we mentioned earlier, data quality at scale is absolutely fundamental for us. Mm-hmm. So we're making some investment into our internal tooling and people and processes to make sure we can continue to do this. At this point, it'd be remiss not to touch on AI and ML technologies. Mm-hmm. We're increasingly looking at ways that we can use these to free up our talented data and research colleagues so that they're not focusing time on menial tasks and really are doing high value actions that make sure we're delivering the best possible data for our customers. Mm-hmm. And we see that as a key part of doing this at scale.
Yeah, no, I think that makes a lot of sense. And it's a common pattern that we see actually widely in the industry that a big part of the impact of different kind of AI and machine learning technologies is that augmentation of kind of existing resource, allowing people to focus on more customer value, which obviously we all love. So Jack or James, I mean, would you be able to maybe share with us an example of how those kind of data and insights have shaped the direction of an existing kind of feature or project that you've already been working on and perhaps change how that turned out?
Yeah, absolutely. So we kind of really lent into analytics in a big way about 4 years ago. Mm-hmm. As we started to map user journeys through our platform, one thing that jumped out at us was like the vast majority of them seemed to end in a download action. And that was kind of a strong indication to us that people were taking our data off a platform to take actions with it. So we saw that as a trigger, and we spoke to a number of customers and really wanted to understand the why. Why were they doing this? What were the problems they were trying to solve? And what became clear was there was this absolute appetite to consume data in their own ecosystems, their own systems and workflows. Mm-hmm. And that was really the trigger for us to invest into our Preqin Anywhere initiative. Right. So we started to build out data feeds and APIs. And what came out was that customers really wanted to see this in a number of ways, quite often in their CRM systems, but also increasingly into data warehouses and to drive analytics. Mm-hmm. It really served as a trigger for us then to kind of invest in this and crucially solve that customer problem of not having busy investment professionals manually moving data around, but letting technology do the heavy lifting, mm-hmm. and again, freeing them up to do the more valuable actions in their day.
Oh, brilliant. So a recurring theme there around getting to customer value a bit faster, and it's very aligned with the kinds of things that we try to help a lot of our customers do. So I suppose a kind of a natural question from there is, as you've gone through this journey, this transformation of bringing in more data, insights, analytics into the way that you prioritize your product roadmap and what you do with your customers. Are there any of those areas where I guess AWS has been a catalyst or something that's helped you along that journey?
I think AWS has really aided that journey. Going back to what we said before about scaling and flexibility and what we focus on, a lot of the commoditized services are really helpful in getting towards these goals we find our users need. So I think search on platform is one example where we've gone with an AWS service around open search, and that's really enabled us to leverage it without having to really operate at a level of detail that means we have to hire, you know, that expertise and, mm-hmm. and other things, the kind of things you would usually expect from using cloud providers.
Mm-hmm. That's a really interesting example there, James. And I suppose one thing we haven't really talked about yet is, as you kind of increase your organization's ability to make these kind of decisions, there's a kind of prerequisite there that you kind of have to have a bit of a data-driven culture, that your people have to think along the right lines to be able to make those kind of decisions. So I suppose I'd love to know, how do you foster data literacy within your teams at Preqin?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's been a journey, but I'd say probably the main way we've done that is to bring our products and data teams closer together and really put data at the heart of our products and engineering process. One practical way we've done this is to embed analysts and data scientists right into the heart of those teams. You know, a major cultural shift I think we've made has been to focus on product outcomes that are measurable too, and avoid the trap of becoming a feature factory, as it's all too easy to do when building product. What we've really done is incentivize people to become data literate and ultimately more customer centric as part of that. Mm. I'd say, like, more broadly though, as a company, we've tried to kind of build this in right on the onboarding process. So when somebody joins Preqin, they'll go through a fairly kind of intensive process of learning about our customers, our data, and the broader alternatives market. Yep. And ultimately, you know, that will put data at the heart of what they do, because they're doing it from day one.
I'd love it if you could maybe speak to some of the challenges that you've had kind of building that data-centric culture within Preqin, and how did you go about kind of overcoming those challenges?
Mm. So, of course, there have been challenges. I mean, every business, as you say, is going to face some challenges when making a cultural shift of any sort. But I think the challenges for Preqin around this data centricity have been mainly to do with the way we've reorganized in the last few years around business units and this cross-functional teams that we mentioned. We've had challenges naturally from that around communication and other things, and I think we've had to really make sure that data, in the way that we're talking about it now, is included in that transition.
No, very good. Very good to hear. So I'd like to shift gears for a moment and maybe talk a little bit about tooling. You know, there's been a real Cambrian explosion of kind of different tools and platforms and everything promising more scalability, more ability to take on huge volumes of data, you know, the ability to create more and more accurate models and things like that. But one thing that we've often thought about here at AWS is advising customers to use that right tool for the right job. And I suppose with that in mind, you know, how do you make technology decisions internally that help you actually support your strategy?
So we actually have a governance process for that, which makes it sound quite restrictive, but actually anyone can instigate that. And I think that gives us the ability to include a diversity of opinions, and anyone in the business can really interact with that too, because it's accessible. It's not just about technology, it's about mm-hmm. you know, the outcomes we're searching for.
Yeah.
And also, I think we'll talk to AWS, right? We'll talk to our technology partners. Anyone you know, that we're interacting with on that level to get advice, and I think that's very valuable a lot of the time.
Yeah, that's very good to know. And I suppose, how do you then strike that balance? You know, there's always new things coming out, new frameworks, new tools, new methodologies. How do you strike that balance between experimenting with shiny new tools and using kind of tried and tested and true existing methods that you already have?
So I think that boils down to, you know, the balance is really between innovation and stability, right? I think that you can fall foul of just jumping on the next trend and it comes back to bite you, or there's some aspect of it that wasn't quite a good fit. So we actually have an innovation account it's another AWS account that we call the innovation account, and that's a place for us to explore these technologies and implement stuff in there. And in terms of like our customer interaction, we actually have like beta testing and A/B testing as well. Which can help us as well make sure that you know, things like performance and other aspects are like going to provide that value for our customer.
Mm-hmm. Oh, brilliant. So I suppose on the subject of shiny tools and new techniques and things like that, what are you doing at the moment with generative AI? You know, we touched on this before, but it'd be good to get an idea of kind of where you're at with that and how you're thinking about it.
I think like any company that has a technology function, you know, we're looking into generative AI, and we're obviously experimenting with it in various contexts. Mm-hmm. And I think, Jack, you've got something to say about that as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's great, and you know, we'll stay close to it like pretty much everyone in our field. You know, what I try and focus on, though, is not to get distracted by the technology too much and make sure we're staying laser focused on the problems we're trying to solve. Mm-hmm. And if Gen AI is the answer, then great. Mm-hmm. But there may be other easier ways to do that. So we want to stay responsible, we want to stay cautious, but obviously kind of trying to leverage this technology where it makes sense for us. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we want to stay focused on the outcomes for our customers. Yeah,
no, definitely. I think we've seen that a lot with a lot of our customers, that they start with kind of lower hanging fruit, things that are a bit less controversial, a bit easier, that don't require as much perhaps thought on the privacy, security, and the ethics, frankly, a lot of the time. Good to hear that. Now, Gen AI is just one catalyst for our industry as a whole. I mean, things are moving really, really fast. I think things are evolving faster than we've ever seen in the software industry and in financial services as well. I guess as these disruptions play out, how do you kind of envision the future of the industry and how data might shape that?
I think in the industry, there's more data collection happening than ever before. And I think there's a growing appetite to adopt technologies to make sense of that data and also scale your business to cope with the increased demand that comes from that.
But I think, you know, the challenge of more data is how to make sense of it, right? So the challenge to us and companies like us is to really distill that into those valuable insights. Mm-hmm. And to that end, we're trying to lean into personalization and try and understand the jobs that our customers do and serve those relevant insights at the right time, mm-hmm. so that they're deriving as much value as quickly as possible.
I love it. Just-in-time data for just the right decision. That's a really exciting future for sure. I suppose as you look forward to it, how are you thinking about your company's data strategy evolving to try and help customers with that?
Yeah, I mean, I guess the starting point is to make sure that we continue to maximise value. We're fortunate to be part of a rapidly expanding market. To the end of 2023, global alternative assets under management were around $16 trillion.
Gosh.
By 2028, we predict that to be in excess of $24.5 trillion.
Wow.
So lots to play for there. I think the challenge is therefore for us to make sure that we continue to collect data and deliver it on quality and deliver it to customers in the way and the manner and the channel that makes the most sense to them. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, make sure that we continue on our mission to bring as much transparency to private markets as possible.
Mm-hmm. I want to thank you both for the time you've given us today. But just in terms of one final question, I'd love to ask you to kind of leave the audience with something tangible, something actionable. I suppose for businesses starting out right now on this journey, what advice would you give them in getting started in creating a data strategy, data culture, data platform to serve their company going forward?
I think for any business starting out, it's important to identify what value you're providing to the customer and work backwards from there. And then from that basis, you can decide what the essential tools are you need to provide that. Mm-hmm. And then you should look to leverage commoditized services and things like cloud providers like AWS, so that you don't have to spend an awful lot of time and energy figuring out the nuts and bolts. You can move straight forward and get to that value sooner. I would also say that it's important to embed the importance of data in your culture and your values of the business from the beginning. I think there's a lot of missed opportunities with collecting the right data, particularly in startups. And I think that embedding that in the values and culture can really alleviate that problem.
Well, thanks both for coming in today. It's been really fascinating to talk about your journey, creating this kind of amazing culture of data and this data strategy that you have at Preqin. I suppose if our viewers want to find out a bit more about you, where can they go? Where can they find out more information about Preqin?
Yeah, absolutely. We'd encourage you to follow us on LinkedIn and also go onto our website, preqin.com, check out the Press Hub and find out much more about us. We'd love you to do that.
Jack, James, thanks so much for the time today. And to our viewers at home, thanks very much for tuning in. This is AWS for Data.